thank you for joining another episode of SFU Change Makers. In this series, we're exploring our SFU researchers' work in the area of COVID-19. And I'm really pleased today to be joined by Professor Peter Unrau. Peter's a professor in the Department of Molecular Biology and Biochemistry, and he's also a Michael Smith Foundation Senior Scholar. Welcome, Peter. It's great to have you with us.
Hi, Joy. I'm really pleased to be here as well.
Great. So we're going to talk a little bit. I understand you've recently been funded through a rapid call from CIHR for research addressing COVID-19. And I'm wondering if you can just start by telling me a little bit about the project, and maybe a little bit of background about the project as well would be helpful.
Okay, so I guess I'll start with a little bit of background about what our lab normally does and how everything changed sort of the middle of February, which was when everything kind of got galvanized across the world about what to do about COVID-19. So our laboratory is very interested in RNA and its role in life. So mostly we're studying things like how did life get started, where we think that RNA is an important role in how the very earliest life might have started, because it can contains information and it can also catalyze chemical reactions. So it's a very interesting molecule. But more and more we've been working on RNA biology, and would it be possible to effectively image RNA within cells? And so before the turn of 2020, we'd been just working on the development of RNA imaging technologies, which when the COVID-19 epidemic came to the front, positioned us really quite well for applying for these CHR rapid research response grants. So before February of this year, we'd not been working on COVID-19 or any viral systems whatsoever. So this is quite a change for us. But we do have some quite interesting technology that perhaps I can tell you a little bit about later.
Great. And so you were able to quickly pivot, obviously, to take your technology and to think about how it might apply to a virus like or a disease like COVID-19. So can you tell me specifically about what you're doing and how you're interested in developing testing techniques? Is that right?
Yeah, that's a project that in 2019 we'd been working on with a company in the Lower Mainland called Applied Biological Materials. They had been interested, first of all, in selling our technology, the fluorophores for our technology, but also in developing some test kits for tissue culture. Often you can have tissue culture which is contaminated with either bacteria or even eukaryotic contamination. And we wanted to develop a quicker test than their RT-PCR test that they were selling. And so we got a small grant, a BC Ignite grant to actually work on that. And we decided to focus on testing solutions that are simpler than RT-PCR. And the complication with RT-PCR is that it enzymatically is not that bad, but you need quite expensive equipment to do RT-PCR, particularly real-time PCR. It's like $70,000 to $100,000 for a real-time PCR machine. And so we decided if it was possible to do an isothermal test, we could probably make the testing machine much cheaper than if you had to use a real-time PCR machine. And that could possibly also make it simpler for somebody like a technician to actually operate such a test, such that you wouldn't need as an advanced training to actually perform the test. And so both of those ideas were kind of important for this more rapid tissue culture test. And so when February of 2020 happened, we happened to have this nearly developed. Actually, we have one more year to develop it, but at the moment, we seem to be only working on COVID-19. But so we're trying to rapidly develop this COVID-19 test using this isothermal methodology, which uses our RNA aptamer, which we call RNA Mango, which fluoresces once you've actually made the aptamer inside the test, which is kind of a novel twist to a normal fluorescent test.
So just maybe a few more words about RNA, about Mango and what Mango does, that would be helpful.
Yeah, so RNA Mango was originally developed in our lab for testing, or for actually just monitoring RNAs inside living cells. That was our goal. And we've through a set of very fruitful collaborations. We've got a suite of these aptamers that we can actually express inside cells. The small molecule fluorophore that these aptamers bind to is not fluorescent strongly at all until it actually binds to the aptamer. And so you have this background of very low fluorescent dye inside a cell. The aptamer binds to the fluorophore, and then it suddenly becomes bright, sort of like an enhanced GFP level of brightness, which allows you to see the RNA, whereas it was dark before. So now as the RNA moves around and it performs its biological function, we can track it. That was a strong motivation, still is a strong motivation of what we're trying to do with RNA Mango.
So similarly with the testing then, if one wants to do testing for virus, it would have specific RNA and that would light up basically through the test?
Yeah, so the isothermal test basically is like a PCR, but it's with RNA rather than with DNA. So it actually amplifies RNA. So by amplifying the viral a segment of the viral RNA, and attaching a Mango aptamer to each of those segments as they amplify, we're able to detect the presence or the absence of a viral RNA. So it's quite a general technology in principle. So it doesn't have to be for COVID-19. It could be for anything that has an RNA target that you would like to detect.
It's interesting. So, I mean, you know, I listen to the news all the time and everyone's talking about the need for rapid testing. And so obviously the work that you're doing is going to be really important in terms of its contribution. So how far away are we from being able to, I mean, I know this is the $1 million question, literally, but how far are we from being able to develop a rapid test? Using this technology.
Yeah. I wish I could promise you a date by which we would be done. I was trying to list all of the criteria by which we have to get right for the test to be fully useful, right? So it has to be really reliable.
Right.
It has to be really simple in principle. It has to be super sensitive, actually. That's actually a complicated part for viral testing because it's not trivial. There's very low concentrations of RNA relative to other kinds of testing that you would do, and it shouldn't cost very much. And often optimizing all of those things, they're all kind of orthogonal to each other in some sense. So it's actually a really complicated problem. So we're hopeful. We have companies that are very interested in manufacturing instrumentation, mm-hmm. which is there's one component. We're working very hard on the isothermal enzymology and stabilizing it. That's our main goal right now. We've only done this for a couple of weeks, and we've made a lot of progress actually in stabilizing the reaction. We want to get lyophilized reagents such that you could maybe store it in the fridge and then pop it out and then work with it for the day or whatever, so that it's not, again, making it simpler for somebody to actually implement the test, so that you could imagine maybe a town hall or, you know, an airport or something like that actually doing the test rather than the sort of centralized testing facilities that are being used for testing right now.
And you have a prototype of sorts, though. I mean, I remember you showing me an image of a prototype of sorts, right?
We've got a little device. It just has to be heated to 41 degrees C inside, because that's what the enzymes like to be at. But that's a much simpler device. We think that's sort of $500 or less to manufacture something like that. You know, you could almost throw that out after you've used it. And you could imagine looking through the top of it, and if it was glowing in a certain pattern, this would mean you're infected or safe.
So Peter, do you need to have access to live virus to actually be able to do this test? And how's that going to work?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. There's several solutions to that problem. One of them is to buy commercial RNA that has been cultured at a commercial a fairly high level biohazard facility. The other is to actually get SFU's biohazard facility that can handle this particular virus up and running. And I think that's going to happen early May, actually. When that happens, our virologist, Masa Nakura, will be culturing live virus and we'll be getting RNA extracts from it. But it will also allow a whole range of other experiments to be performed here, such as testing viral inhibitors that Rob Britton, one of our collaborators, has synthesized in his lab and would like to test their ability to inhibit growth of this virus. And there may well be other ramifications to having that facility up and running here. I think that was the original intent of it, actually, with the SARS virus, which didn't spread, fortunately, like like the coronavirus that we have right now, which is spread all over the planet. But so yeah, it's good that we have this facility here at SFU.
Yeah, thank you so much. It's so interesting to me how we all are able to, you know, pivot quickly. In your case, get your research up and going. But for us at SFU, to get a lab also repurposed so that it can handle this hazardous material. You know, the other thing that's interesting right now, Peter, is how challenging it is with COVID-19 actually happening, because you also have to physically distance in your lab as you're trying to do this work. So how hard is that these days?
Well, we took a couple of pictures of that. So here's a picture of the lab before COVID-19. It's actually not everybody in it, but we only have a subset of the lab working on COVID-19.
Nice and close, yeah.
Yes, and here's a picture of them working after COVID-19. So they're all wearing their protective gear, and they're holding 70% ethanol bottles, and they're all properly spaced.
But it's excellent.
Very pleased to hear that. I mean, it is important for people to know that our research is ongoing at the university, specifically in relation to this kind of research, this COVID-19 research. So that's, I think it's terrific. But I know it's extra complicated. That's for sure.
Yeah, there's a lot going on. We're very excited actually about the CIHR Rapid Response Grant and what we can do in addition to this work. Actually, there's a set of collaborators that I'm really excited about. Rob Britton, who's a chemist. We've got Masa Nakura, who's a virologist. We have two clinicians who are actually gathering samples right now at St. Paul's Hospital, Don Sin and Mark Romney, who's actually doing testing at St. Paul's Hospital, and an engineer who's involved in the prototype devices, Mike Adachi. And so soon we'll have a CL3 level facility, we hope. And there's a lot more that this won't really touch directly on the rapid testing that I've been talking about, but it will allow us to actually, Rob has compounds that may be inhibitors of this virus, and the CL3 facility might very well be used to test those compounds. So we're hopeful that we can do a lot here at SFU. So,
yeah, no, I'm hopeful as well. Yeah, that's great. So I'm interested, as a final note, this technology also ultimately, I mean, we're all worried, like, what's next? We've got COVID-19 today, but potentially there'll be other, you know, viruses that we'll need to be concerned about. And this could pivot to other types of pandemics as well, and be useful in terms of rapid testing, I assume.
I think so. I mean, we really need something that's as reliable as the standard pregnancy test that you can buy in the drugstore right now, right? If you could get something that reliable, and you could change it so that, you know, this year's flu could be detected, for example, you know, you could imagine going to the store, buying your test kit for the year or whatever, and say, well, you know, I'm feeling sick. Do I have the flu? No. Or do I have something worse or whatever? Right. If the testing is developed properly, we should be able to be quite programmable in the kind of detection that will be possible. And if we can make it cheap enough, then, you know, hopefully it can be much more routine, that you could figure out what you've got, you know, decide to stay home, or decide that, you know, there's some big problem that you better alert authorities about. But at the moment, it's just not there. So I think the whole world is trying to solve this problem at the moment. And we're playing an aspect of a role in solving this problem. So it's a very exciting time. It's a very unsettling time at the same measure, but it's just, you know, we're trying our best to make progress as rapidly as possible.
Well, Peter, I really appreciate you taking time out from your lab to talk to me today. It is so impressive what you're doing, and also so interesting how you're involving clinicians, engineers, others in terms of trying to get this work done. So thank you very, very much.
And thank you very much, Joy. It was a pleasure to be here today. Thanks.